Hello, and thank you for joining. I'm Julianne Bittner, and this is Insight with Insiders. Besides my high energy and intestinal fortitude, I'm an extremely passionate person who loves to empower staffing owners through education, resource, and expertise. It's why I started this podcast series, Insight with Insiders. I wanted to bring industry experts to the table to discuss the challenges, issues, and emerging trends in the staffing industry. Today, I've asked David Searns, CEO of Haley Marketing, to join me. Let me tell you a little bit about David before we start. When it comes to marketing a staffing firm, few people know the industry like David. He literally grew up in the industry. He has been helping staffing companies create innovative marketing strategies and award-winning websites for more than 20 years. I think you're going to be 25 years this year, correct?
It is.
Great. Fantastic. Congratulations. So Haley Marketing, a few of their services is website design, CEO, social media, blogging, email marketing, PPC. For more than 20 years, Haley Marketing has served the staffing industry. Their work has won more than 65 Genius and Voice Awards from ASA. They can help you stand out, stay top of mind, and sell more. It gives me great pleasure to introduce David Searns, Haley Marketing. Welcome, David, and thank you for joining us.
Thanks, Julianne. Glad to be here. Yeah, I can't believe 25 years. Jeez, I'm going to be in denial for the rest of my career of how long I've been around this industry.
But yeah, isn't that funny? I hit 30 years in the industry in October, and I said, oh, I started when I was 16. Really? Really? I'm not that old. But it's a great industry to serve. It's exciting. It's always rewarding. And you have to stay on top of things lately, don't we?
It's been different, that is for sure. 2020, pandemic aside, but I mean, if you just take the way the industry was this last year, I've never seen anything like it, including multiple recessions, boom periods. It's just been crazy.
That's the truth. I know. You think you get to understand it once you've gone through a recession, and then you have this past year, and you're like, wow. Wow, this is so different. So let's talk about that. Over the last several months, one of the top questions that I've been asked by clients is, what are you seeing with your other clients related to recruiting challenges? And what are the other clients doing to attract candidates? So when did this recruiting problem start, and how big really is this issue?
So it's interesting. So Julianne, if we went back an entire year, let's go back to a little bit for me. Let's go back to March, you know, when everybody started locking down last year.
Right.
You've been through recessions. You remember the pain of the Great Recession. You see businesses closing, and your first reaction has to be, oh my gosh, this is going to be like the Great Recession on steroids. This is going to be horrible. And we assumed that there would be this crash in demand for staffing services, because in a down economy, the first thing to go, unfortunately, are temporary employees, and that kills our clients.
Right.
Except it didn't happen. So we had this kind of period of uncertainty, call it April, May, June, followed by essential personnel, healthcare, needing to go to work. And demand for talent increased, even though unemployment went to 16.5%, demand for talent for most of our clients went up. But now people wouldn't go to work, either because they were afraid,
right?
They couldn't in their area. I don't even want to get into schooling challenges, but think about all the moms and dads that suddenly are now school teachers, and they can't work regular schedules, or they can't. A number of households that normally have two working parents no longer can. So you've lost a huge chunk of the workforce. So we saw it. This started probably about July, August of last year, that recruiting got tough. Then came 2021, and we went from tough to virtually impossible. And I can tell you the date. It was March 11th. So literally to the day, we watch data on people applying to our clients' websites. We read the data from Indeed, and we're on top of what's happening out there. It was March 11th. So what happened on March 11th?
Right. Well, I was going to ask you that. What happened on March 11th? Had to be one of the
last stimulus package was announced.
Last stimulus, yes. With the extended
and I know
federal.
Politicians want to say that right now that the challenge of getting people to go to work has nothing to do with them and has to do with the weakness in the economy. But everybody in the staffing industry knows that's not true.
Right.
Demand right. for talent is through the roof, but supply is ridiculously low. And if you think about it, now it's probably not impacting high-level professionals. It's not impacting healthcare in the same ways, although a lot of healthcare professionals are just burned out from a year of COVID.
Oh, yes.
But if you look at the light industrial, the blue-collar workforce, the lower-level white-collar workforce, anybody making less than 20 bucks an hour. So 20 bucks an hour is $40,000 a year. If you assume the average family is four people, those people just got handed $5,600, $1,400 right. times four. Okay. Mm-hmm. They got handed that in 1 month.
Right.
Okay. So that's,
a lot of
their annual
money.
Income as supplemental income in 1 month.
Right.
To people who aren't used to having a lot of supplemental income. They're not used to, I mean, it's great. If they put some money away, they can now have money for an emergency, which they never had.
Right.
But for a lot of people, that had the opposite effect. That de-incentivized, I need to go to work. I don't need to take the gig job. I don't need to take the temporary job because I'm not strapped for cash this week, next week. Then you add in the enhanced unemployment benefits. And okay, right. now I can get my regular unemployment plus another $300. So that's going to be, depending on where you live, $12 to $13 and change an hour effective hourly wage to stay home.
Right.
Then you add in, I don't have childcare and I'm still a little afraid of maybe getting sick. Where's the incentive to work? So
right. And the ACA changed. So a lot of them are getting coverage now, yep. Either COBRA coverage, extended COBRA coverage that they're not going to have to worry about. They're not to pay. And they get ACA, that whole gamut of the cost of ACA changed. So it went much lower than it was before. Yeah. Big changes. It's interesting. I was reading over the weekend and you and I were talking about a little bit before we got on, that there's changes being done in different states because of this problem. I mean, if I've gone to a Starbucks that says we're closed because they can't staff it, I've gone to restaurants and heard them say, we are only taking 50% reservation capacity, not because of the COVID restrictions, it's because they don't have enough staff. And then you look at people saying, no, we can't find jobs. There's more jobs available probably than there are unemployed right now. And then Montana and South Carolina just passed, if I'm not mistaken, June 1st, they will not allow they're not taking the federal supplement any longer, right? There people on unemployment will not get that federal supplement.
Yeah, I think Montana was sort of reversing it, or I may have the states wrong, but where they were actually going to pay people a bonus at the end.
Yes,
being employed. Mm-hmm. It's like, what a great way. We're going to give you an extra payment for taking a job. I love that.
Yes, yes. $1,200 they're going to give you for taking a job. Unbelievable. And I know I got a call yesterday, a client in Georgia said Chamber of Commerce there, reached out to staffing owners saying, talk to your Congress, do what other states are doing like Montana and South Carolina so that we can get rid of this federal unemployment stimulus or supplement, I should say. And so we can get people back to work. So you're right. That is a big problem. So then how do you get people to apply to jobs? It's the biggest issue to the problem right now is getting people to apply because of the things we just said. Are there things that companies, staffing owners can do to get employees or candidates to apply?
Yeah. So Jane, there's not a silver bullet. There's not one thing that we're going to come up with here and say, if you just do this, that all of a sudden your recruiting woes are ended. You almost have to have a strategy of saying, I'm going to try to find pockets of talent everywhere I can. So where can I find pockets of talent? Mm-hmm. First place that people should be looking at is inside their ATS. So using automation tools, using texting, using good old fashioned pick up the phone. We have a client that we help with their recruitment marketing. We manage their ad spend for them. And we were talking with them and they're going into their ATS, going back to the day they were founded in 1996.
Wow.
And the recruiters are not thrilled, but they are calling every candidate they've ever worked with, not just to recruit, but to catch up. And one of the people on our team had a great point, said, you know, somebody you placed 17 years ago, they're now a generation further into their career. So right. they may have kids that are working now. They may have other family members. They have a new friend set, or they may now be potential clients. So I think it's a great exercise. It's a lot of work, but that's one thing is how do I leverage automation technologies? How do I leverage more phone time with my team to reconnect with all the people we've helped in the past. So that's the first thing.
Mm-hmm.
Next thing is, how can I find people who are going to go to work? So there are people working. Maybe they're working for a competitor. Maybe they're directly working with an employer they don't love. I have to find ways to target people that are actively in the job market. It's a different advertising strategy. It's not just run the ad on Indeed. Here's the pay rate. Here's the duties and responsibilities. I have to think about completely changing the messaging in my advertising to reach the audience. So if you are working, this is where employment branding becomes really big for staffing companies.
Mm-hmm.
Why would somebody choose working for my company? Or if I'm a candidate, why would I choose your company versus another staffing company versus the direct employer? So this is a time that staffing companies, it's another pocket, is we have to make the people, candidates who are working, want to work for us. So what about our candidate experience is different, better? I was talking to a client in Ohio last week, and he's going through the same problems. And I said, do you have any name brand clients that are really big draws? And he said, yeah, I've got a couple of them. I've got one in particular. They hire more than 2/3 of the people we supply on full time, and they're an incredible employer. Everyone wants to work there. I said, can you start co-marketing with their logo, their brand in your ads? And most staffing companies are like, no, my competitors will call on these people if I give out their names. And thankfully, the CEO said, he goes, we've already started, because we know this company is such a draw that the fact that we have openings right now, and they're not going to last, that will get people to call us. And he said, we're finding more and more of our clients, our clients normally would say, no, you can't use our name. Our clients are saying, whatever it takes to get us talent, we're willing to do. Okay. So they're using company names, they're using logos, they're negotiating for higher pay rates. So I think most staffing companies are already doing this. Like, I talk to the clients, show them the data and say, hey, in our market, there's a magic number. So in every market, you're going to find a magic number that if you advertise a job at a certain pay rate, that magic number is where you start to get applications. Right now, it's probably around $16 an hour, but it's going to vary by market.
Right.
It's not just the equivalent of being unemployed. It's higher than that because there's a cost to people to go to work. There's a childcare cost. There's a time cost. People, you have to have enough differential above unemployment for people to go to work. So we're seeing some markets, it's around $16 an hour. You can tell where it is in your market by testing in your ads different pay rates and looking at how many applications do I get based on pay rate for similar kinds of jobs. And then you show your clients, hey, if it's at $13 an hour, here's what we get. If it's at 15, it's at 17. This is the number of applications we're seeing. So that tries to get the client to do more. And my last point about getting those people off the sidelines is fear of missing out. We've all heard of FOMO, right?
Mm-hmm.
So if you're a candidate and you're on the sidelines right now, there has never been a better time to find a high-paying job, to find a job at a great company, to find a job that's convenient to your schedule, that's on your bus route.
Mm-hmm.
This is the time to get the job you really want. If you wait until extended unemployment ends or until they change the rules in your state, and now everybody jumps back into the labor market, you put yourself at the middle or the end of the line. Right now, you're the front of the line. And I think staffing companies have to leverage that to their advantage to say, if you get at the front of the line.
That's a great idea. Great advice. I mean, we've had three openings here for months at Tricom trying to, and you know, in our management, we've been talking about, okay, like you said, look at the pay rate. You got to increase the pay rate. But you also have to sell who we are as a company better and stronger. So people who are working today want to leave that position and come and work for you. And when I talk to people who are getting out of school, in, you know, students who are coming out of school going, no, I'm going to wait for a while. And I've said, you're going to be behind the line. You're going to be at the back of the line, because right now you have full control. You actually can actually counter on rates and say, you know what? Yeah, I don't want 40,000 a year. I want 45,000 a year or 43. And they'll probably meet you in the middle because everybody's looking for people. Yeah.
Yeah. It is at all levels. The demand for talent is a challenge. And then the other thing that's going to happen is everyone is predicting this great wave of transition. I think for hospitality, it's going to be particularly difficult because a lot of people are just saying, I've had it. You know, I'm done with dealing with the public. Mm-hmm. And, you know, people haven't been that easy to work with in the last year. Mm-hmm. And I've talked to a lot of people in restaurants, like just they're tired of belligerent customers.
Right.
And so they're just saying, I'm not going back to the career I had. Or you're also seeing this huge wave of people in their 50s or early 60s now saying, I'm going to retire early because 2020 taught me I have to live my fullest life because I don't know what's coming next.
Right.
So what does that mean? Well, that's a threat and an opportunity for companies that are hiring, because it's a threat that those people you thought loved you might just be having a change of heart about their lives.
Right.
It's not a matter of you as an employer, but you still could have huge turnover. And the other side, it's a huge opportunity because now if you build that, as you said, sell the Tricom brand, why work for us? What's our value proposition? If that's really good, you can probably attract better talent than you've been able to get in the last 10 years.
Yeah. We're looking at flexing the people that we can when we bring them back to the office. I mean, there are positions we cannot flex them to work from home, but if we really can, and we'll put a group together that says 8 days a month, you're allowed to work from home. I would never have thought of that if you asked me that in 2019, end of 2019. I'd be like, no way. Everybody has to come to the office.
Yeah. I don't even think that is up for discussion anymore. Like if you're not a flex environment, I understand some jobs you can't do remotely, but if you don't have some sort of flexibility in your schedule, you're going to be so far behind the eight ball competing for talent versus companies that are offering it. I don't think everybody has to be full-time remote to succeed, but you have to give people flexibility. We just surveyed, we have 52 people and we surveyed our staff and said, okay, who wants to come back in the office full-time? And if you don't want to come in full-time, how many days a week ranging to one to full-time remote, do you want? And the majority were 1 or 2 days in the office.
Really? Okay.
Yeah. And I thought it was going to be 2 or 3. So I was surprised to see it was down to 1 or 2. People are enjoying it. They don't want, the majority wasn't zero, but it's got us rethinking, okay. You know, the scene you see here, I'm sitting in my office. So we have a building here with today. There's 2 people in our building that holds normally 45 people working in the building.
Wow.
And that's all we've had. So we're going to rethink it. Like, how do we relay out the space? Because all those cubicles we spent all that money on, they're garbage now. Nobody wants a traditional desk with, they want to come in and they want a co-working space.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. So we have to rethink that. So that's what a lot of the businesses have to do in order to see those candidates, unless they get anybody in there looking interested in their business. So you have talked in the past, I've heard you talk about the 4 pillars of recruiting marketing, that Haley Marketing kind of, we have, it's funny because we have the 4 pillars of service for Tricom and you have the full 4 pillars of recruiting market, recruitment marketing. Can you tell us about it?
Yeah. So it's really thinking about the ways to attract talent and to get, and I'm going to, there technically is a 5th pillar, but that's what recruiters do for a living. That's direct recruiting. So the 4 pillars, the first thing is your career site or the career portal section of your website. We see staffing companies all the time that spend tens of thousands of dollars on advertising and Indeed and Zip, and they're bringing candidates in. Then candidates get to the website and it's a terrible experience, so they don't apply to the jobs. So you spend all this money to bring somebody to your site who doesn't apply. And so that's the first pillar, is the career site. And are you maximizing conversions? People who visit your website or visit your jobs to actually apply for them. So how do I make the apply process faster and easier? How do I make sure that it works on desktop and mobile? What do I do if somebody doesn't have a resume online to attach a resume? Can I handle that situation? How do I make it as easy as possible for the candidate to take the next step, but not just applying for jobs? When somebody comes into my website, maybe they're reading a blog post, maybe they visited the homepage. How do I steer them to go look for a job so that they're taking the next step? So I avoid losing people. And one of the things staffing companies can do is they can jump into Google Analytics and you look at something called entry pages and exit pages. So where did somebody enter my website and where did they leave? If they didn't leave on a page that says, thank you for applying to our job, there's still work to do to make that website perform better. So that's the first thing, is improving the site. The second pillar is job advertising. So it is the biggest recruiting expense outside of the recruiters that most staffing companies have is how much am I spending on ads, Indeed, Zip. all the other career sites. Mm-hmm. So historically, decisions were made decentralized. They were made based on annual contracts. And they were made by recruiters or branch managers determining where to spend that budget. Mm-hmm. What we're arguing is now you really need to centralize it so you can get control over the spend. You need to ditch the annual contracts and be going to flexible spend. So if it's my busy season, I spend more. And if it's my non-busy season, I spend less. And then you need to use software to help manage that so that you could actually have a professional approach to figuring out where to spend that budget most efficiently. So that the buzzword is programmatic. It's programmatic management. It's software that you set rules and you learn over time. And the combination of somebody's expertise in those rules allows you to take your budget and avoid spending too much on jobs where you didn't need to and not spending enough on jobs that really needed it. So that's the second pillar.
Okay.
The third is social recruiting. So we all live on social media, and 2020 mm-hmm. saw the volume of traffic on social media double, a 200% increase on our time.
Wow.
Like, I hate that iPhone notice that comes out. For me, it's on Sundays that says, here's how much time you spent on your phone last week.
Mm-hmm.
I've intentionally been leaving my phone behind because I hate saying, oh, look, you spent 4 hours a day on your phone. You're kidding me, right?
Right.
And I am in denial all the time. Like, the phone's lying to me.
Mm-hmm.
But the reality is we're all doing that. So when we get people on their phones, on social, as a staffing company, how do we engage them? How do we have one strategy for active job seekers who are on social media? How do we have another strategy for passive candidates? Mm-hmm. I'm actually working with someone, they're not in the staffing industry, they're outside, but they came to us because they have a huge recruiting challenge. They need to recruit about 16,000 people.
Oh my.
Now, I can't get into who they are and what they do,
mm-hmm.
But they have a huge recruiting challenge. And what we're looking at is, well, you need a multi-layered social strategy. At the top layer, you need to basically sell why get to work. Then the middle mm-hmm. layer is why work in our industry. Then the bottom layer is why work for us. I think that's the same for staffing.
Right.
Why get off the couch? Why work as a temporary, or why work with a staffing company, and why work for ABC staffing? And then this company said, you've got six distinct buckets of candidates you recruit from. They recruit people who are either right out of high school, or early college. They recruit people who are early retirees looking for a second income. They have a big focus on recruiting for veterans. And then they had a couple of other talent pools that if you look at each one of those groups discreetly and you look at how they use social media, they're on different social channels. They consume different kinds of content. They just look at the world differently. So you need a content strategy, active and passive job seekers, those three layers, times those different audiences. It's very complex
wow.
to put all that together. But if you
right.
really want to engage people on social media, you need to talk to them like they are, not like you are as an employer or as a staffing company. And that's all part of the social recruiting, is thinking about how do I create these strategies and then use just organic sharing from my company, use paid sharing to get my message out in front of more people, and then use team-based sharing, getting all my recruiters involved in sharing content to get people to find it.
Mm-hmm.
And that brings us, it kind of ties directly to the last of the pillars, which is your employment brand. And that's where we started. What are you known for?
Mm-hmm.
What's your value proposition? And does that employment brand come out in everything you do? Are you a fun company to work with that's, you know, that you want that effervescence to come out in everything you share on social media? Or are you buttoned down, serious, and that's our employment brand? That should come through, and you don't be disingenuous. If I'm the old school IBM, you know, what was it, white shirt, blue suit.
Right.
Mm-hmm. If that's your company brand, well, don't go be something else on social media and then bring people
right.
in that's not authentic. You need your social brand to be authentic to your employment brand. So those are the four pillars of recruitment marketing.
Okay. I'm surprised how many staffing companies don't know their brand really, really well. And then there's ones that know it exceptionally well that I follow. And I'm like, wow, they are a fun company. You can clearly see working from them. They're going to be fun. And they do a really great job. And you and I've talked about one of them here in Milwaukee that I'm just very impressed with, because they're always out on social media. It doesn't matter if I open up Instagram, Facebook, LinkedIn, they're there. They're always there. And it's multiple people in their organization. Everybody's connected. Everybody's doing something, which is a lot of work. And that's why I think people say it's too much work.
They do a fantastic job. And one of the things they do that I like a lot is, you said, they get everybody involved and it's about fun. And I think that's the brand is about internal recruiting for, you know, they want recruiters, they want salespeople. So that brand is about showing they're a great company to work with. But if you extend it one further, very, very few companies. I can think of one down in Mississippi that does a really nice job with demonstrating their candidate experience through their employment brand. I mean, their social media is all about the way they treat talent. They're not the same. They're not the fun like it's the company in Milwaukee. But you can clearly see they care about the people they're placing. That comes out. And Jane, I couldn't agree more with you that so many companies, you're in staffing, you're in the business of having an employment brand. So many companies don't have a brand for the temps. They may have a brand for the internal employees. They have a brand for themselves as an employer. But they sometimes may think of, well, I'm representing my clients, so my employment brand doesn't matter. Well, it does, because your employment brand is how you treat the candidates. And that's got to come out in social.
Right. Social is so important today. It just really is where everybody's living, no matter what page or source it is. If you don't like Facebook, well, then get on something that is more the trend right now. I haven't seen TikTok being used, but I'm sure it is being used.
We've seen a few examples of it. Usually it's tends to be younger recruiters. And what they're trying to do is demystify the process of working with them, making themselves, it's about personal branding, but they make themselves very approachable. And like, okay, this is just, here's this lady, Sally, and Sally's like, just like, seems like a great person. I would want Sally to help me get a job. And that's how they're seeing it. Some people are, I haven't seen as many, but it's a few examples of trying to use it to profile jobs. I think that might be a little bit harder. Because you don't have that long with the video, but I do see companies using more Facebook, more Instagram. What's it like to work in this job? What's a career like in this industry? I saw a company website, they do locum tenens. So they're recruiting physicians, and they have a whole website that's all about what's it like to be a locums doctor? Because if you've never done that before, you may not understand what that world is all about. And physician recruiting is so hard that they're just trying to help the candidate put themselves in the shoes of the locums physician to say, oh yeah, that could be me. This would be really cool.
Great idea. Any other trends you're seeing that people should be paying attention to with either technology or something else?
Yeah, one I was going to go down, and I'll apologize for being a little self-promotional, but this is a frustration we were having, is you mentioned how hard it is to get people involved in social media. So everyone will admit to, it's a great idea. We want people to do it. Some companies will even give their employees the time to do it. Some don't. But it's hard when somebody's selling staffing for a living or they're recruiting to get people involved in sharing the company content. So we got frustrated that we couldn't get our clients to do it. 25 years of being in marketing in the staffing industry, and no amount of begging, pleading, cajoling could get all the salespeople and the recruiters to share content. So we built software to do it. It's called NetSocial. And I'll give you a use case that, rather than a sales pitch, the use case, we actually had a university out of Utah contact us saying, we have 39 recruiters and we need to recruit college professors. So we're really, really good at creating content to resonate with the people we're trying to hire. Our recruiters, we have dedicated talent acquisition people. We can't get them to share anything.
Oh my.
It's so frustrating. So they found us and said, let's try this product. And so what their marketing team does is they build what's called a content channel of all the stuff they wish the recruiters would share. And then the recruiters subscribe to these channels and then hook it up to their social media. And then they get an email notification that just says, you want to share this? Click the button, yes. Or if they don't even want to be bothered with that, they can just turn it on auto share and they don't have to do anything. And just automatically goes out for the recruiters.
Excellent
so
idea.
They just said, like, this is exactly what we needed. It ended the teeth pulling that we were trying to do to get people to share our content. And I think that's one of the trends, is team-based sharing has a big impact. So if you can get your people to do it organically, that's the best. If you can't, then you look for automation to supplement.
Call Haley and they'll help you on that. That's a great idea. Let's talk about the salespeople for a little bit, because this is extremely difficult times, unprecedented recruiting strategies. which should, besides sharing more, as we said, right, getting involved in social media, what should salespeople be doing?
I think recruiting and staffing is an incredibly hard job right now. Selling mm-hmm. might be worse because right. you know going in the door that you know you got a client who's got demand. So that part's mm-hmm. easy. You've probably got more demand than you ever had. I've talked to more clients and said, we've got people coming out of the woodworks who wouldn't right. talk to us a year ago, 2 years ago, who said, we never use staffing, and all of a sudden they want to talk to us.
Right.
But now if you're in sales, I think the hardest thing is working with the client. You have to be more consultative than ever, setting realistic expectations. Look, I get mm-hmm. it. You have this job to fill. But at $12 an hour, I'm not going to get any candidates. So right. I think the salesperson has to be able to bring data to the meetings, figure out where that ideal point is in the market and show the data saying, when we advertise jobs for other companies at these pay rates, here's the level of applications we're getting. So I think you have to be realistic to help the client say, okay, I've got to readjust my thinking on pay. And if they won't, salesperson's got to say, look, I love you, but I can't work with you because I'm not going to walk in and be a failure because of the market. I think more salespeople are struggling with that because who in sales ever wants to say no?
Right.
But you can't afford to waste your time. So you
But if you have right. But if you have all these clients to deal with and you can't fill them, pick the ones you are willing to the clients are willing to work with you, listen to you, hear you, that you know you can have a better odds of filling that position than clients that you're gonna run around never filling those positions. So you gotta pick and choose
exactly.
your clients.
You know, everything we've been talking about employment branding, salesperson could be sitting down with the client saying, look, right now, I can't just put your job up there with a pay rate and have people apply. Those days will come back, but right now they're gone. So let's sit down together and figure out everything that makes your company desirable. I want to make a list of that because mm-hmm. I'm going to hand it to our recruiters so we can use all of that when we're selling your business. We're not selling your job anymore. We're not just going to our ATS and pulling a name out and sending it in. We have to now go represent your company in a way that we've never had to represent you before. So we need a closer relationship. So we need to know more about your employment brand. We know more about this job. Oh, and by the way, the salesperson has to be able to go, this job sucks. We need to work on making it better. What can we do to make this job not suck? Can we give schedule flexibility? Can we provide someone with a bus pass? Can we give them some training so the next job they'll get paid more? Can we give them temp to hire opportunities? What can we do to make this job more saleable? Because candidates, it's a limited pool and the candidates have tons of choice. So if you're selling the worst product, it's a really hard time. You need to improve the product. I think salespeople can do a lot to work with clients to try to help the client think about their employment brand.
Okay. I think you had mentioned earlier the companies and the staffing company need to work together, maybe even branding, meaning what you had said earlier, probably putting their logo on the staffing, right?
Yep.
Working with them with even their logo of the company, if their name is big.
Yeah. This one might be more controversial, so don't hate me for the idea. But if somebody in your market's a really well-known employer and anytime you post a job, you know you're going to get candidates, then what can you do to offer that company a great rate, an incentive, a reason mm-hmm. they'll work with you? So they may get the first pick of the litter of the talent, but you get everybody else. And so how mm-hmm. can I win over those marquee clients? What can I offer them? And it might require an incentive, lower markups, discounts, maybe even like do so much in temp with us and we'll do some free temp to hires for a free direct hire recruiting for you. Mm-hmm. But be creative to win those companies over with the understanding I am going to leverage your employment brand to help bring you the best talent. And I'm going to give you a deal because I'm going to get candidates that you're not going to hire. And that helps me help more of our other clients.
Mm-hmm. Okay,
so great. I think it's a harder sale, but the more you can leverage really great clients, that helps you as a staffing company strengthen your brand. They say as people, you know, we're the average of the five people we hang out with. Mm-hmm. Kind of same for staffing companies. You're sort of the average of the clients you serve. And publicly, let's focus on all the clients people know, because that raises who we are to the top of the market.
Mm-hmm. Right. Excellent. We saw interviewing, video interviewing this last year come to fruition. Like that's how everybody was doing interviews. How about job posting, video job posting? I'm seeing some of that come around now. Are you seeing that trend?
Yeah. So it started, I mean, there's been a couple of vendors that specialize in doing video job posts. Actually had a startup reach out to me recently to get feedback on the business. I think video job posts are a great supplement to text. I think, you know, sort of like resumes, like if I can read a resume, that's great because it's fast, but it doesn't give me a lot of information about the candidate. If I had a video interview to the resume, now my finalist candidates, I've reduced the amount of phone screens that I need to do. Same thing for the candidate. You know, if I go to Indeed and I see 100 jobs that say forklift driver, what does your facility look like? What does your equipment look like? Where am I going to be working? Give me a feel for the job. Or even if it's the recruiter, let me meet the recruiter I'm going to be talking to, because a job post in text is very cold. It's very static.
Right.
Right. A video either demystifies the job by showing me what to expect, or it warms up the company by letting me meet the recruiter. It does both. So Jen, I think videos are an awesome idea. I think it's just like getting people to share on social media. It's been really hard to get people to do it. You know, but we all have a high quality video recorder in our pocket.
Right. You don't exactly.
You don't need fancy film production. You need a phone.
Right.
And there's very, very low cost software. If you want to make it look a little fancier to add your logo to it or call to action, you can get ridiculously low cost software to help with that branding of the videos. But now get your recruiters on camera. To have your recruiter go out and talk to a client where you can go face to face, and where you're allowed to show the actual facility. If it's a nice facility, show it off. So, and I think it's a great idea. I think staffing companies should start with building libraries of their most common jobs so they can just reuse the videos, but where they can have the recruiters make those more personal videos about specific jobs, make a big difference in getting people to apply.
Yeah, I think if we could, like for us, if we walked around with a camera, our phone, and did a recording of the environment and the people and who you're working with, I think it sells the company completely different than it does in the ad. So it's getting people comfortable. Everybody does think you have to have a professional. I used to think that until this last year, and we're like, oh, here we are doing podcasts and postings on LinkedIn, and I don't have any equipment. I have a laptop, and you know, you tape it, and we're like, you got to get comfortable with it not being so perfect, because we're all part of that in the regular social world. It's not
I think everyone's used to that video is, you know, does not have to be high quality professionally produced. I'd hate to be in the video production world, because they probably will argue with me left and right, but you can do the things that are low cost and expensive. One of the things we've done with new hires is, because I think we've added 10 people remotely this last year. We've got people now that I've never met in person, which is weird.
That's crazy. Right. Right.
So when somebody starts to introduce them to the team, we have a piece of video software we use that it lets us ask three questions. And so the person gets their phone or their webcam, and the software says, here's question number one. And then they answer it. And then question two and question three. And it puts it all together as this little meet me video. And we do it for new hires internally. So when they join the team, everybody else can meet them and, like, you know, what were you doing before you came to Haley Marketing? And what are you excited about working for us? And what else do we need to know about you? Set of questions. They're great. And each answers like 30 seconds of whatever they want to say, but it's an instant way to get to meet your teammates. But I could see recruiters, staffing companies doing that exact same thing with a client saying, let me ask three questions of the supervisor to get that person talking about the job, because who's going to sell it better than the supervisor?
Right. Right. I agree with you. No, yeah, right. I would hope so too. Excellent information. Anything else you want to share? I mean, this is a great dialogue, great conversation today. I appreciate it.
Oh, thank you. Right now, as I said at the beginning, there's no one thing that's going to work. And so, you know, my concluding thought here is to be creative, is to brainstorm. And if I can get 50 things that add one candidate, that's 50 more fills that I get. The other thing that's related to that is also, if I've got candidates coming in the door and I don't have a home for them, this is what I need to tell my sales team, is we need to always have a home for every placeable candidate we get so that we can maximize our fill percentages.
Excellent. Great information. Thank you. David, it's always great to see you and talk with you. I appreciate your time today. Look forward to our conference in fall. We'll be seeing each other in person finally.
Right? I know. So can't wait for ASA in Denver. Thanks, Julianne.
Yeah, thank you. You have a great day and talk to you soon. Thanks.
You too.
Bye. All right, bye-bye.